Hello everybody, in the last class we have studied pollination and its types, the transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma is of three types: autogamy, geitonogamy and xenogamy. And we have also studied how it is classified as self-pollination and cross-pollination. According to our textbook, we have to study one of the contrivance of pollination for autogamy. In autogamy, a common example is of the Camelina bengalensis. In autogamy, there is an example called Camelina bengalensis. Now this plant, it produces two different kinds of flowers. One is chasmogamous flowers and the other are clistogamous flowers. What is chasmogamous and what is clistogamous? The flowers which are produced on the branches which arise above the soil surface are chasmogamous flowers, and these flowers are normal opening flowers or blooming flowers. Their calyx, corolla, androecium and gynoecium is totally exposed into the environment, and natural pollination occurs, self-pollination occurs in those flowers also. Those are called as chasmogamous flowers. Another kind of flowers known as clistogamous flowers. Clisto, the word itself means the flowers are closed flowers. In Camelina plant, there are branches of the trees which grow under the soil. The branches, they remain under the soil. And these plants, they produce flowers which never open. The underground branches of the plants in Camelina produce flowers. Such flowers are called as clistogamous flowers. These are clistogamous. What is the word clistogamous? The word clisto refers to closed flowers. The flowers, as are present underground below the soil, they never open. They remain within the bud condition. But in such clisto gamous flowers, the androecium and gynoecium mature at the same time. Means homogamy exists. Homogamy is maturation period of the androecium and gynoecium. When is the same, it is known as homogamy. And in such flowers also, closed flowers also, when androecium and gynoecium mature at the same time, only and only self-pollination, that is autogamy, can take place, and cross-pollination is completely avoided. So when a flower, due to some adaptations, favors only one kind of pollination, such a characteristic is known as contrivance for pollination. Here, Cleistogamous flowers of Pamelina favor only and only autogamy, the self-pollination, totally avoid cross-pollination. Hence, it is an example of contrivance of autogamy or self-pollination. So in this, the contrivance for self-pollination in Pamelina, 2-3 words are important. Homogamy, both male and female reproductive structures mature at the same time. Chasmogamous, the flowers, open flowers which are present on the upper branches of the plant. Cleistogamous, closed flowers which are produced underground, and these closed flowers show homogamy, never open. Autogamy, the self-pollination is compulsion. Xenogamy, the cross-pollination is completely avoided. Hence, it is a contrivance. The Cleistogamy is a contrivance in Pamelina to achieve only and only autogamy. An example given in our textbook within a box. Today, we shall study agencies of pollination or agents in pollination. What do we mean by agencies of pollination? In the last periods, we have come to a conclusion now that the male and female structures in case of angiosperms are non-motile. They cannot move by their own. Maybe the pollen grains or also the female gamete or female structures. Here everything is non-motile. And therefore, to bring the two structures, the pollen grains, the male gamete, the female gamete, the stigma, whatever the process may be, to bring the two gametes closer to one another, we require some kind of external factors or agencies for pollination. Mostly, the agencies of pollination are required in xenogamy and also to some extent in geitonogamy. Even though in a single plant if pollination takes place, some kind of agents may be required or required. Mostly it is the autogamy which does not require generally the agencies. Now let us concentrate on the word agency. These are the things, the factors, which bring about the process of pollination. The factors are the things which bring about the transfer of pollen grains from anthers to the receptive stigma are known as agencies of pollination or agents of pollination. May not be required in autogamy more, but compulsorily they are required in geitonogamy and xenogamy. What kind of agents or agencies are these? The agencies which help to achieve a pollination are classified into two types. One is abiotic agents, another is biotic agents of pollination. As the words themselves say that abiotic means the meaning non-living agencies of pollination or agents of pollination are there. Some of the living agencies are there, therefore it is grouped under biotic agents of pollination, means living agents of pollination. We have to study both of the types in somewhat detail with respect to the adaptations present in the flowers to achieve the type of pollination with the help of agents. So let us first of all study abiotic agents. The non-living things which bring about the process of pollination, the non-living things which transfer the pollen grains from the anther to stigma are called abiotic agents. These can be of two types. One is wind, another one is water. The pollinating agents which are wind and water, the abiotic types, are more type, these are the types which are more primitive, and also they also help in large number of plants to achieve the pollination. So first of all, let us see wind. The pollinating agent by wind is known as anemophily, or the process of pollination which is brought about by the agency of wind is called anemophily. The most common types of plants through in which the pollination takes place by anemophily or wind are maize and jawar. Maize, jawar, rice, wheat. These are all the examples where pollen grains are transferred from anthers to the stigma with the help of the wind or air. In all these things, the most important part here we have to concentrate is adaptations. This is the most important word. Adaptations in which structures? Adaptations in flowers. Now, as these are the examples for anemophily, what type of adaptations are present in the flowers or developed in the flowers to achieve anemophily or to achieve pollination by wind? Let us study these adaptations in the flowers with respect to the maize plant, or in general the adaptations in the flowers can be studied. Whenever anemophily is there, we can in general say, by looking into the flowers of jawar, maize, sugarcane, rice, etc., we can say that the flowers are very small, inconspicuous, not clearly visible with the eyes. The flowers are very small, inconspicuous, colorless. If at all you visit the monocotyledonous plants or a plant of maize, jawar, sugarcane in the flowering period, you go and look at the flowers. We cannot clearly distinguish those flowers. As we can see, rose, China rose, tube rose, hibiscus, these all flowers we can clearly see as they are colored, visible, large, but the flowers of maize, jawar, sugarcane are very small, inconspicuous. Then they are colorless. Most of the flowers are produced on a single structure. Aggregation of flowers is seen to form a single ear-like structure in these different types of plants. Then comes the stamens. What kind of stamens are there? The stamens in case of wind-pollinated plants are with versatile anthers, special type of anthers in which the anthers lobes are very long, the filament is attached exactly in the center of the anthers, loose attachment of the filament is present, and these anthers, they freely swing in air. Now within the anther, the pollen grains are very small, produced in very large numbers, because wastage of pollen grain may take place during the process of pollination. As the pollen grains are to float in wind, they must be light in weight, they must be dry. Then comes the stigma. The stigma in case of most of the plants, it is feathery, so that the pollen grains which come through the wind can stick into the feathers. They can be captured into the feathers of the stigma, and then the hairs of the stigma, feathery stigma, and then the further process of the pollination and fertilization is carried out. So these are the important aspects, adaptations of the flowers are important when we study agencies of pollination or agents of pollination. Abiotic agent means non-living, wind and water. Wind means to attract wind. The plants do not have to spend their energy. Normal growth and development takes place. Non-living water, there is no attraction. Therefore, they do not have to develop any extra structure. So, first, wind pollination means the pollination which is brought about by wind is anemophily. Examples, maize, jawar, sugarcane are the common examples where pollen grain is transferred to the stigma by wind. The most important part here to study is adaptations in the flowers. Go to the plant, maize or jawar, observe it carefully. You can then say that the flowers are small, colorless, inconspicuous. After flower, come to the stamens. In stamens, the anthers are versatile, produce many number of pollen grains in them to compensate the wastage of pollen grains during the process. As the pollen grains have to float in air, they must be light in weight, very small, dry, and many in number. Adaptations are important. After knowing the common adaptations, either maybe in maize, jawar, sugarcane, every wind pollinated plant, after studying the common adaptations in the flowers, here we have to study one example, a common example with little diagram. That is of maize. In our textbook also, a diagram of maize plant is given, labeled with the male flowers at the top. So now here you have to concentrate on the type of the flowers. The flowers at the apex, the comb which is present at the apex consists of only male flowers, and in the leaf, in the axil of the leaf, the female flowers are present. Here, female flowers are present. These are the leaves, the stem, the root, all the labelings have been clearly given in the textbook. As our classes are online, you will have to go through the textbook also thoroughly, draw and practice all the diagrams given in the textbook. Labeling is a compulsion in examination also. Without labeling to the diagrams, you cannot score marks. Therefore, all the diagrams given in the textbooks are essential. So coming to the maize plant, the part or the apex of the plant is terminated with the help of a comb consisting of male flowers. And in the axil of the leaves, there is the inflorescence of female flowers. This is the inflorescence of male flowers. This is female flowers. It means that the flowers in maize are unisexual. They are not bisexual. Male flowers, only one inflorescence at the top. Female flowers, many in the axils of the leaves. Male flowers here, the versatile anthers are present. Then the stamens, pollen grains are small, produced many in number, dry, light in weight, so that they can freely float in the with the wind current. The female flowers also have the grains which are produced here. We can see these are actually the flowers, first ovary style stigma. The hair-like structures, the tassel, the generally word tassel is also used. The tassel or the hairs which we see on the inflorescence are nothing but the style and stigma. Gynoecium consists of carpels. The carpels in turn show ovary style and stigma. These hair-like, tassel-like structures are nothing but the style and stigma. They have the capacity to catch the pollen grains during the process of anemophily, and then they later take part, the pollen grains take part in fertilization, and thus grains are produced on the female with the help of the female flowers on the female inflorescence. So this is regarding anemophily. Many times while we study some of the topics, we get confused or we won't remember many of the words. For such aspects, you have to read and read textbook many times, draw the diagrams, try to understand it, and you can also raise questions if at all you have on our group. The WhatsApp group is there for our class. You can raise the doubts or questions within the WhatsApp, and there we can solve your problem. Another abiotic agent is water. The pollination which is brought about by the agency of water is known as hydrophily. The plants which live in water, there are many hydrophytes. The word hydrophytes refers to the plants which grow within the water. And such plants, they show pollination, or the pollination is brought about, the transfer of pollen grains to the stigma, from anthers to the stigma, is brought about by water, the current of water, floating water. And when the pollination is achieved, it is called hydrophily. So what is hydrophily? The process of transfer of pollen grains from the anthers to the receptive stigma in hydrophytes brought about by the agency of water is called hydrophily. Hydrophily may be of two types, hypohydrophily and epihydrophily. Some plants show hypohydrophily and some plants show epihydrophily, or follow hypo and some follow epihydrophily. First of all, let us study the same thing, adaptations in flowers of water plants. Water plants, Zostera, Vallisneria, these are the examples for the water plants. Plants which grow in water, the hydrophytes. So here, the adaptations are more or less, few of the adaptations are same in both, in anemophily and hydrophily. The first one, the flowers are small, then the flowers are colorless, inconspicuous both same. Why both same? Because abiotic agent small, colorless, inconspicuous. The extra word here is in hydrophily, the parts of the flower are unwettable. They are covered, the calyx, corolla, or the other essential ones are covered by a wax-like substance, which makes the parts of the flowers unwettable. So first adaptation, the flowers are small, inconspicuous, colorless, and unwettable. Next, second, the pollen grains or the stamens are also unwettable. The flowers produce the pollen grains which have a waxy coating over their surface, and therefore they do not get destroyed with the water. The important part in the pollination of hydrophily is the pollen grains have to develop their own specific gravity, because when we say water, few of the flowers, the female reproductive flowers may come on the surface of the water. In some plants they remain in between the surface, and in some the female flowers may lie at the bottom of the water. So in order to float according to the level of the stigma, the pollen grains, the male reproductive bodies have to be of different specific gravity. So these pollen grains develop specific gravity. How do they develop specific gravity? By producing starch grains in them. Pollen grain, starch grains. So depending upon the type of pollination, hypohydrophily or epihydrophily, specific gravity differs in the different plant pollen grains, and this specific gravity is developed with starch grains. Less specific gravity, less starch grain in the pollen grains. If the pollen grains need to be heavier, more specific gravity, more starch grains are developed in the pollen grains. So specific gravity of the pollen grains plays another important role in hydrophily. The stigma is sticky in case of hydrophily. So what are the adaptations? Adaptations in flower always essential. What are the adaptations of hydrophily? The flowers are small, inconspicuous, colorless, covered by wax. The parts are covered by wax, so unwettable. They do not get destroyed by water. Secondly, in the stamens, the pollen grains are produced. These pollen grains, they develop their own kind of specific gravity. The specific gravity of the pollen grains is developed by producing starch grains in them. Now, let us study first of all hypohydrophily and then epihydrophily. What is hypohydrophily? Hypo, the word you generally know that something below. When the pollination, the transfer of pollen grains from the anthers to the stigma takes place below the surface of water. So this diagram is of epi. We are studying hypo. In hypohydrophily, the pollination is achieved below the surface of, not here, here, below the surface of water. So in hypohydrophily, the pollination takes place below the surface of the water, and the pollen grains here, which are produced for hypohydrophily, have more specific gravity. They have more specific gravity than that of water. More than water, therefore they lie below the water. So the pollen grains for hypohydrophily have higher specific gravity than that of water, and hence they can float under the surface of the water and bring about the necessary pollination on the stigma. In case of Zostera, the pollen grains are needle-like at the apex and they are without exine. So such pollen grains are there without exine. These pollen grains without exine, needle-like, when come in contact with the stigma of the Zostera flower under the surface of the water, they coil around the stigma without exine, hence can get coiled with the intact over the stigma, and the pollination is achieved. The diagram here shown is of epihydrophily. Epi, above the surface. Hypo, under the surface. For epihydrophily, these pollen grains or the male flowers float on the surface of the water. The pollen grains also float on the surface of the water. It means the specific gravity is less than that of water. Hence, they float on the surface of the water. In hypo, they move below the surface of the water. Hence, the specific gravity in hypohydrophily is more. Zostera example, pollination is underground. In epihydrophily, the male plants in Vallisneria are separate and female plants are separate. The male plant produces male flowers. These male flowers in the Vallisneria plant, when they get detached from the parent plant, the flowers, they remain floating on the surface. Flowers, they remain floating on the surface of the water. When these flowers come in contact with the stigma of the female flower, then pollen grains are released by the male flowers, and this is takes place in them. Pollen grains are released and the necessary pollination takes place at the surface of the water, hence called epihydrophily. The female flowers also show a different kind of adaptation. So these are the female flowers. In case of Vallisneria, the female flowers have a very long stalk. This stalk is very long in the female flowers. Initially, the flower's stalk is coiled and the flower remains under the surface of the water. But when the stigma matures, or the ori-style stigma matures, the stalk of the flowers, it becomes straight. First coil, at maturity, it becomes straight, comes on the surface of the water, and the pollen grains then get stick to the stigma. The pollination is achieved due to the water. So such type of adaptations in the flowers, either may be for hypohydrophily or epihydrophily. In case of hydrophytes, the water plants, is also to be studied in detail. Next comes the biotic agents for pollination. What are biotic agents? the pollination which is brought about by living organisms, the insects, the birds, the bats, snakes, ants, different animals, most of the pollination, 80% of the pollination is brought about by biotic agents. More than 80% of pollination is brought about by biotic agents. The living organisms help in the transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the receptive stigma. All such living organisms are agents. What kind of agents? Biotic agents, living agents, which help to achieve a desired type of pollination. Accordingly, here we have to study these three different types of pollinations. The pollination brought about by insects is called as entomophily. The transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the receptive stigma with the help of birds is ornithophily. And the pollination which is achieved by the bats generally during the night times, the bats, is known as chiropterophily. Further, the pollination may be brought about by snails, ants, other animals, snakes. Hundreds of different types of biotic agents are there, but here entomophily, ornithophily, chiropterophily are the three types which we study in detail. First of all, let us know entomophily. What is entomophily? The pollination which is brought about by insects is called entomophily. The transfer of pollen grains from the anthers to the receptive stigma by the insects is called entomophily. Most of the pollinations of biotic types are brought about by insects. There are many types. Of these all, the most important, because it is the most types or many plants, insects are the pollinating agents, hence entomophily is the most important. Now come to the adaptations in the flowers. I have said that Whichever may be the type, the important aspect is adaptations. The characteristics present in the flowers to achieve the definite type of pollination by different agents are the adaptations in flower. What type of adaptations are present in entomophilous flowers? In entomophilous flowers, the flowers are large. If small, they are arranged in a group. They are colorful to attract the insects. Conspicuous. Jawar flowers, maize flowers, we cannot see even from closer eyes, with eyes. But the other flowers, the flowers of sunflower, the flowers in case of China rose, tuberose, many other plants we can see from long distance because they are colorful, conspicuous, little larger also. These are the flowers produced by the plants to attract the insects. So the flowers are large, conspicuous, brightly colored. Secondly, the flowers produce fragrance. Sweet smell in the flowers is there. Here no fragrance, no smell, not needed for wind and water. Here needed to attract the insects. So fragrance, then nectar, juice is produced within the flower to attract the insects for pollination. Then the pollen grains which are produced for entomophily are spiny and sticky. so that the pollen grains can stick to the body of the insects. The stigma is also sticky, gum like. If you touch the stigma, it will be like the gum. Sticky stigma is there. So adaptations for abiotic and biotic differ totally. While studying adaptations, comparatively study even in the textbook. So what are the floral adaptations for entomophilus? The flowers are first of all large, brightly colored, then conspicuous. Even if small, they are produced in a group. Secondly, the pollen grains are sticky with spines or variously sculptured. The stigma is also sticky so that the pollen grains can stick to it from the body of the insects. Honeybees, generally the most pollination is brought about by insects, and that too honeybees are the most common types which bring about most of the pollination in the entomophilus types. There is an example given in our textbook which shows some special mechanism to bring about pollination by insects. In case of salvia, there is an example called salvia, and this salvia follows entomophily. In salvia flower, the pollination is brought about by insects. The salvia plant, it has the flower . This is the flower, kind of flower in this salvia. It has two stamens, and the stamens are bifurcated. What is bifurcated stamen? The bifurcated stamen means the connective here is bifurcated. Connective is bifurcated. This is the stalk of the stamen. Connective is bifurcated. This is the sterile anther. This is the fertile anther. Whenever an insect or honeybee visits, when the insects visits the flower, it sticks on the filament of the sterile anther. And at this moment, when the insect sticks on it, the upper fertile anther along with its connective, they bend down. And the pollen grains stick to the body of the honeybee or the insects. Such a mechanism of bending down of the connective, the bifurcated connective of the fertile anther or fertile stamen on the honeybees or the insects is known as the lever mechanism. With the lever mechanism, the pollen grains of the fertile anther, they get stick to the body of the insect or get deposited on the body of the insect. The same insect, when visits another flower on the stigma, by chance the pollen grains may get attached on the stigma and the pollination may be achieved. So such special lever mechanism is present in the salvia flowers to achieve the entomophily type of pollination. Pollination, which is brought about by the insects, is known as entomophily, and such flowers are known as entomophilous flowers. Normal pollination through insects also takes place. Commonly, the pollen grains are attached to the body of the insects. When the insects fly from one flower to another flower, stigma may receive the pollen grains from the body of the insects. In salvia, this is the special mechanism to achieve the pollination. The liver mechanism is the special mechanism to achieve entomophilous pollination. The rest two, ornithophily, chiropterophily, we shall discuss these two in the next period. Thank you.